Good morning and welcome to the Manchester Church of the Brethren worship service today. We are live streaming here from the sanctuary. I'm Kurt Borgman, and here with me helping with the worship service are Lila Hammer, Seth Hendricks, David Hupp, Luann Harley, and Brian Krushwitz. Zach Erbaugh and Conrad Borgman are handling our sound and video. Our congregational hymns for today are For the Healing of the Nations, number 367 in the Blue Brethren hymnal, Carry It On, which will be interspersed with the scripture reading, a song you will easily pick up as you hear it and see the lyrics on the screen, and Lift Every Voice and Sing, number 579 in the blue hymnal. Following worship this morning at 11 a.m., we will have our all-church Zoom call. The link was sent out in the all-church email, but you can email the church address if you need us to send it to you again. We will have a few minutes together as a large group, and then move into two rounds of breakout groups for more personal sharing and fellowship. This afternoon at 4 p.m., there will be a Silent No More anti-racism event in downtown North Manchester to demonstrate solidarity with Black people across the country who have lost their lives at the hands of police. Cliff Kindy from the Eel River Community Church of the Brethren is the lead organizer. Katie Gray Brown from our congregation will be providing some nonviolence orientation and training as the event begins. People will be asked to wear masks and keep distance from each other. The gathering place is the firehouse across from the Lutheran Church. Before the walk begins, there will be some persons speaking and sharing about why the event is taking place and what Black Lives Matter means. From the firehouse, the group will walk to the parking area east of the police station, where participants will read the names of those who have been unjustly killed at the hands of police across our country, as well as hear information about what has been achieved in the past 2 weeks because of the mass protests across the world. The event will conclude with protesters walking back to the firehouse. Please wear comfortable walking shoes, bring appropriate signs that you can carry as you walk. Those who cannot maintain a nonviolent presence are asked to refrain from joining the walk. Again, that's at 4 p.m. this afternoon. Our Manchester Church of the Brethren Witness Commission, which held a special meeting this past week to talk about how to give guidance to our congregation's response and action around matters of anti-racism and systemic injustice, encourages our involvement as a congregation in opportunities like these. The commission is also talking about further steps that we might take in terms of education and engagement as we seek to live out Christ's call to stand with and to stand up for the marginalized and oppressed in the world. There's no offering time during our online worship service, but I do encourage you to mail in your pledges and offerings by mail to the church post office box or use the online giving option on the church website. To donate online, look for the donate button on the front page of the website and then follow that to the online giving page where you can enter your information to make a one-time or recurring donation. Please consider using the ACH option instead of the credit card option, as the church pays less in fees if you use ACH for your donation. Again, I would mention the special quarterly outreach offering that we are collecting in the month of June. The offering is for the Church of the Brethren Children's Disaster Services, and specifically to buy supplies for kits of comfort for children affected by disasters. The kits, designed in cooperation with the Red Cross, have 23 items each, including things like Play-Doh, finger puppets, small bean bags, a jump rope, a paint set, and so forth. These kits are especially helpful during this time when face-to-face ministry by CDS volunteers is not possible. You can participate in the Kits of Comfort project by making a donation through the church, either by sending a check to the church and marking on the memo line quarterly offering, or by using the special Children's Disaster Services donate button on our website. Also, we are arranging for family groups or individuals to come assemble kits in the Family Life Center on an appointment basis, 10 kits at a time. The schedule and invitation has been sent out to younger families as well as families with youth, and we hope to gather just a few more volunteers. I think there are just a few slots remaining, and we hope to have those filled today. The assembling will take place Monday through Thursday this week. Also, watch the church newsletter and the church Facebook group for educational pieces around disaster ministries throughout the month of June. As we look forward to welcoming Amy Gall Ritchie to our pastoral staff in just a couple of weeks, a pastoral welcoming committee has been formed. They have met and are asking you to please help extend a welcome to Pastor Amy and introduce yourself in two ways. First, by making a short video of yourself, introducing yourself by name, and sending that video to the church office by email. And then second, by offering contributions to a welcome basket. Those items could include things like gift cards, notes of welcome, suggestions or recommendations for community resources, and can be dropped off at the church in the mailbox by the staff entrance. Both of those projects are described in more detail in the church newsletter. Please respond by Friday, June 26th. Timbercrest has some needs for part-time employees to help with delivering meals in the manor and assisting with feeding persons in healthcare, as well as persons who would assist with a new outdoor visitation program between residents and their family members. See more details in the church newsletter, and if you're interested, you can apply through the Timbercrest website. That is, finally, all the announcements for this morning. Let us continue in worship.
I like things organized. I'm a planner, organizer, detail fanatic. I like to make lists and mark things off the list. Sometimes I put tasks that I've already completed on the list just so I have the satisfaction of marking them off. In preparation for a vacation or a trip, I develop a timeline for preparing and packing. I create a list and categorize all the things we need to pack and the tasks that need to be completed before we leave. I make lodging reservations well in advance and create an itinerary with dates, reservation confirmation, and detailed information about stops along the way. I like orderliness. I like breaking projects or tasks into small steps. I like to plan my work and work my plan. I'm a detail person. That can be a blessing and a curse. We rarely forget things for a trip. But I can become so focused on the list that I forget to enjoy the preparation and anticipation of the journey ahead. Sometimes I wonder what it would be like to get up in the morning, pack an overnight bag, jump in the car, and just head out to see where we land. but we've never quite been able to let ourselves do that. In today's scripture, Jesus instructs the disciples to go out and spread the good news. Now, I'm sure in that group of 12 guys, there was at least one planner, organizer, list maker like me who said, "Okay, Jesus, well, before we head out, we need to work on a strategy and develop some talking points for our presentations, and we'll need to send word ahead to let them know we're coming. And we'll need to make a list of things to take: food, clothing, extra sandals in case they wear out on the trip, bedrolls, and oh yeah, what about a hostess gift?" I doubt Jesus ever rolled his eyes, but he probably shook his head slightly and said, "No bag, no money, no reservations, no extra sandals, and don't be concerned about what to say." I can imagine the anxiety for some of those men. Could I have followed Jesus' instructions then? Can I follow him now? Can I step out of my comfort zone? Do I have enough faith to let go of my own needs to share the good news to those who need to hear it today?
For the healing of the nations, Lord, we pray with one accord. For a just and equal sharing of the things that earth affords, to a life of love in action, help us rise and pledge our word. Lord, your people into freedom from despair, your world release. That redeem from war and hatred, all may come and go in peace. Show us how through care and goodness, fear will die and hope increase. All that kills abundant living, let it from the earth be banned. Pride of status, race or schooling, dogmas that obscure your plan. In our common quest for justice, may we hallow life's respect. You, Creator God, have written your great name on humankind. For our growing in your likeness, bring the life of Christ to mind. That by our response and service, earth its destiny may find.
Please pray with me. Lord of life, you call us to wander off from our predictable paths and to follow you into the unpredictable footsteps of the kingdom. You call us to leave the comfort of our homes and accompany you into the uncomfortable places we try to avoid. You call us to put aside all that entangles us in our crowded lives and to follow you into service to others. Prince of Peace, we gather today not out of habit, but to respond to your call, bringing our willingness to step outside of the familiar and follow you into the unknown. We gather today not only to hear words which can transform us, sing songs that uplift us, but to answer the call to follow. Christ Jesus, fill us with your hope and peace, and equip us for the journey ahead. Amen.
Hello, everyone. My name is Brian. And remember at the beginning of the service when Lila was talking about going on a trip, and every time she goes on a trip, she has to pack all these things and she makes a big list. And she just thought maybe one day she could do it a little more simply. Well, today I want to tell you about a woman who went on a trip without even a bag. And her journey lasted 28 years. Her name was Mildred Norman, but in 1953, she gave herself a new name, Peace Pilgrim. Now, she may have got her inspiration from this Bible verse that we read today for the scripture in Matthew, when Jesus tells the disciples, he's giving them advice to go out on their own, and he gives them some rather unusual advice. He actually says, take no gold or silver or copper, no bag for the journey, or extra shirt, sandals, or staff. I think maybe Peace Pilgrim got her inspiration from this Bible verse. When she started walking, all she took was this tunic. She didn't even have a backpack. And in this tunic, she had a couple pockets. And all she took with her was her correspondence, which is, let's see what that might have been. Pretty much just some paper to write letters. She would get people sending her letters and she would answer the letters. Maybe some envelopes, some stamps, and maybe a pencil or pen. That's about all she carried with her. Let's see a picture of her when she first started on her journey. That's when she was a little younger. And you can see on the back of that tunic, it says walking 10,000 miles. For peace. Let's go to the next picture. After many, many years, she did this again for 28 years. She stopped counting miles at after 25,000 miles. Let's look at the tunic here. On the back of this one, this was one of her first tunics. And all it said was walking coast to coast for peace. She just started off walking across the United States one time, but she ended up doing it more than seven times. This tunic and some other things are at a collection at Manchester University. So if you're interested in going to see this or some of her other things, you can see that at the library at Manchester University. She was also in North Manchester at least one time. So Peace Pilgrim, she called herself a pilgrim because she was on a journey and she had a message of good news, just like the disciples did. So what I want to do now is I have a short video clip that I'm going to show you. And first she talks about her tunic and why she's on her pilgrimage. And then at the end, she talks about her good news. So let's listen to the video.
Traditionally, a pilgrim is on foot. I started January 1st of 1953. I've been walking now for 26 years.
I wish y'all could hear
it. It's what I'm doing with my retirement years. Now, a pilgrim has no visible means of support, and so I have no money, and I don't accept any money. And all I own is what I wear and the few things I carry in my little pockets. I walk until given shelter, fast until given food. I don't even ask. It must be given. And it is. People are good. There's a spark of good in everybody. No matter how deeply it may be buried, it is always there.
So to end our time together, let's repeat her message of good news. I'll say a line and then you repeat it after me. This is the way of peace.
This is the way of peace.
Overcome evil with good.
Overcome evil with good.
Falsehood with truth.
Falsehood with truth.
Hatred with love.
Hatred with love.
Thank you.
I'm going to take us into this time of prayer with a short story entitled The Traveler's Needs. A traveler and his companion prepare to set out on a long journey. In preparation, the traveler packs a second coat. And his companion asks, "Why are you bringing a second coat?" And the traveler responded, "I will need it." The traveler then packed a second pair of shoes. And his companion asked, "Why are you bringing a second pair of shoes?" And the traveler responded, "I will need them." And the traveler then packed extra food into his bag, two of every kind of food that he would bring. And his companion asked, "Why are you bringing two of every kind of food?" The traveler responded, "I will need it." The traveler's companion finally set his small bag down and said, "How heavy is your load? Mine is light. I have but one coat, but one pair of shoes. I have just enough food for the days we'll be walking. You need so much." The traveler said, "Because your coat is thin and your shoes are old and worn, having walked with you, I also know that you grow hungry often." Confounded, the companion asks, "But when I asked you about those things, you told me you would need them, not that I would need them." "You are my companion," said the traveler. "So as long as we walk together, there is no difference between your needs and mine." Now imagine these words, not directed at our close companions, not for those like the 12 that Jesus sends out that are named in the scripture today. These words from the Message translation: "Go to the lost, the confused people right in your neighborhood. Tell them that the kingdom is here. Bring health to the sick, raise the dead, touch the untouchables, kick out the demons. You have been treated generously, so live generously. You do not need a lot of equipment. You are the equipment. Travel light." Let's come to prayer as we consider what it means to care for the needs and burdens of those right in our neighborhood, to care for those that may not reciprocate or even welcome this good news. Still, we journey on to bring hope, love, and justice of God. Let's pray. God, in our neighborhoods, you send us out. And we pray this morning for those around us, staff and residents at Timbercrest and Peabody. For those who bear the extra burden of additional decisions and tasks and work hours. For those struggling with loneliness and feelings of isolation. We pray in celebration with Katie Clark and Bennett Wickenhauser on the birth of their daughter, Aurelia Joanne, born last Sunday. Aurelia's grandparents are Annie and Greg Clark. We pray for Doug Campbell flying to Tampa tomorrow to join a small team closing the Brethren Disaster Ministry site there. We pray for this group as they're responsible for inventory and loading and transporting tools and equipment to the next site in Dayton, Ohio. We join with Jan and David Fairchild to pray with joy at the news that their friend Beth Farney is finally home after 2 months and 2 days stay in the hospital as she was treated for COVID-19. We continue to lift up and hold Elizabeth Schilling as she continues in treatment to address pressures and inflammation caused by chemo and radiation. We remember Jim Carpenter, who has returned from the hospital this Monday with breathing issues. Jim is being treated at Parkview Randalia. And we pray for all those who participate this afternoon in the anti-racism walk and witness in our community. And we lift up our wider neighborhood, the wider community, those praying for change in our country around matters of systemic injustice, racism, and the continual suffering that results. We give thanks for opportunities to witness in concern and solidarity, even as we pray for our own blind spots. Let us be in prayer for our sister church in El Salvador, and for the leadership of their 5 youth houses, that their centers provide safe places for learning and fellowship for youth. For our brethren global partners, we pray for the churches in Rwanda, India, Haiti, and Nigeria. An emergency disaster fund COVID-19 grant was awarded to provide food for 4 churches in Rwanda. In India, the COVID-19 situation has worsened, and there are few tests, and those who are ill are not getting the treatment that they need. So we pray for our brothers and sisters for the First District Church of the Brethren in northern India. And in Haiti, they have received a grant to provide 3 months of food for 800 vulnerable families. And in Nigeria, prayers are requested as there's been a rise in violence, a COVID-19 surge, hunger, and continued Boko Haram threats. Numerous villages attacked. We pray for the staff of Disaster Relief Ministry of EYN as they continue to assist despite the security threats. And we pray for EYN leaders, pastors, as they minister and provide leadership. We pray for our world in this time of uncertainty and unrest, and remember the most vulnerable and the most at risk among us. We come to this time of prayer, remembering back those words from the scripture, "You are the equipment. Go out into the neighborhoods to explore. New strangers await. New places, more attentive, awakened for the hard and difficult journey that lies ahead, bringing hope, loving our neighbors, working for justice." Amen.
Our scripture today is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, verse 35, through chapter 10, verse 23. We will hear the reading in 3 sections, and after each section, we will sing a verse from the song, "Carry It On." Matthew 9, 35 through chapter 10, verse 4. "Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.' Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon, the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him.
There's a friend by my side walking. There's a voice inside me talking. There's a word that needs a saying. Carry it on.
Matthew chapter 10, verses 5 through 15. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold, no silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town.
Stories of an empire and its glories, but a better world to come. Carry it on, carry it on, carry it on.
Matthew chapter 10, verses 16 through 23. See, I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Be aware of them, for they will hand you over to the councils and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak, or what you are to say. For what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise up against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes.
There's a love. For this earth, here is the land. when the truth at last is spoken, and the circle is unbroken, carry it on, carry it on, carry it on, carry it on.
In the scripture text for this morning, Jesus sends his disciples out to carry out a ministry of healing. He does it because the need is so great. Everywhere he goes, people are coming to him, people who need healing. Harassed and helpless is the way Matthew's gospel describes the crowds. Jesus has compassion for them. There is so much hurt, so much pain, so much suffering, so much need. So Jesus gathers his 12 disciples and he gives them authority over unclean spirits, disease, and sickness. He gets them ready to share in his work of healing, his ministry. He empowers them. He gets them set up to carry it out. And he gives them specific instructions. In this healing mission, they are not to go to the Gentiles, and they are to stay away from the Samaritans. They are to go only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. In other words, they are to bring healing first to their own community, to their own family, so to speak. And to recognize that the branch of the family that they will be engaging with is not their immediate family of disciples and followers of Jesus, but the branch of the family, the religious, cultural family, that may well be skeptical of Jesus and skeptical of them. It's an interesting setup. The disciples are to take the ministry of healing to people who may not welcome them with open arms, who may want the actual physical healing, but not the message of the healer. They are to take the ministry of healing to those who aren't necessarily sold on Jesus and his proclamation of the good news of an upside-down kingdom. These are people who are in need, because everyone has need of some kind of healing, but who may not want to be in relationship. They may want the benefit of Jesus' ministry, but without the engagement or the commitment to very different radical idea of the kind of healing that includes not only the healing of physical bodies, but the healing of hearts, the restoration of relationship, the healing of a community of its exclusivism and separation. Healing that comes through the radical transformation of the political and religious structures that keep some on the top and others on the bottom. And furthermore, as he sends them out, Jesus stacks the deck a little further by telling the disciples, don't take your own supplies, your own money, your own resources. Rely on the generosity of the households, the communities to which you are going. Rely on the hospitality of people who will in turn stand to benefit from the gift of your healing ministry. Set an expectation of mutuality. So here's the thing. As he sends them out on this mission, Jesus is making it very clear that he and his followers are not going into the healing business. Healing will not be a commodity. It will be a gift. And gifts are given and received within the context of community, within the context of relationship. Go, he says to the disciples, and see whether people will meet you in this kind of arrangement of mutuality. One that says, I'll help you, and you can help me. I'll take care of you, and you can take care of me. It's actually quite strategic. If people have need of help and healing, and you have the gift of helpfulness and healing, and they would certainly pay money for that help and healing, but as you are offering your help to them, you are also asking them for their hospitality toward you, well then in the process, you'll be pushing these kinds of questions. Can healing be more than just the meeting of an individual's physical or personal needs? Instead, can the healing that Jesus offers, that his disciples offer, be the healing of relationships, the healing of perspectives, the healing of trust, the healing of people side by side, the healing of an entire family, whether family of tribe, the family of community, or even the whole human family. When Jesus says to the disciples as he sends them out, "Be wise as serpents and innocent as doves," I don't think he's saying be two-faced or trick people into buying what you're selling. No, I think he's saying be wise as serpents in that you know very well that in refusing to commodify help and healing, you are refusing to objectify yourself and others. And when you do that, you're going to irritate people. People who would rather hand you their money and be done with you until the next time they need what you are offering. So be wise in that you keep them on the hook in terms of relationship, in terms of the recognition of our common human need. Be strategic in turning things away from commodity and toward relationship. But at the same time, be innocent as doves, in that you will not allow cynicism to rule your perspective. You will not give up on the possibility of a better, purer kind of relationship as you choose to see neither yourself nor them in commercial or commodified terms. Instead, with a kind of intentional innocence, you will deliberately assume the very truest, best, and most hopeful perspective that we are all family to each other. We are all humans to each other, not objects. And that relationship is at the heart of the human experience. Relationship is the bedrock of healing, and it is necessary for justice. Cynics will say that everything has a price, everyone has a price, but that is ultimately dehumanizing. Meanwhile, intentionally innocent people will say that no human can possibly have a price because all are of infinite value. So, wise as serpents, strategic, acting with forethought and intention, but also innocent as doves, believing in the best that we can be, not cynical, but hopeful. Now, I want to also say that being intentionally innocent is not the same thing as being weak, naive, or stupid. Jesus goes on to tell his disciples, if they don't welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off your feet. In other words, do not be surprised if there are wolves in the midst of the lost sheep. Do not be surprised if you are rejected or refused. It will happen, but keep going. Carry it on. Because the truth is that some people will not abandon their intentional commodification of person-to-person interactions because they do not want to humanize those interactions. They do not want to receive true healing, the healing of relationships, the healing of prejudice, the healing of history, the healing of their own vision of the future, the healing of their very hearts and souls. And when you, as a faithful disciple, run up against that, if they will not listen to you, or if they refuse to receive you, shake off the dust and move on. But you know, that counsel is hard for some of us to hear. Sure, there are some among us who find it quite simple to reject anyone who won't listen to us or who disagrees with us, but many of us tend in the other direction. We don't want to give up on anyone. It seems unchristian to shake off the dust. Well, sometimes it is necessary. Sometimes even anger is necessary. Richard Rohr, in his daily email devotionals this past week, has been focusing on contemplation and racism. The specific topic he addressed on Tuesday was contemplating anger. And as I read it, it made me think of the instruction to shake off the dust. First, Rohr quotes Gandhi, who once said, "I have learned to use my anger for good. Without it, we would not be motivated to rise to a challenge. It is an energy that compels us to define what is just and unjust." And then Rohr continues by sharing some words from a colleague, Dr. Barbara Holmes, who says, We all need a way to channel and reconcile our anger with our faith. A theology of anger for communities under siege assumes that anger as a response to injustice is spiritually healthy. My intent is to highlight three ways that anger can contribute to spiritual restoration, she says. First, a theology of anger invites us to wake up from the hypnotic influences of unrelenting oppression so that individuals and communities can shake off the shackles of denial, resignation, and nihilism. Second, a theology of anger can help us to construct healthy boundaries. And finally, the healthy expression of righteous anger can translate communal despair into compassionate action and justice seeking. The question, she says, is whether or not we will recognize our words and the source of our anger so that we can heal ourselves and others and awaken to our potential to embody the beloved community. She says as well that sometimes anger is resistance, sometimes it is grief, and sometimes it is necessary in order to survive. Carry it on. Right? Opposition and resistance is a reality because anytime you get close to someone who doesn't want to face the truth of our shared humanity or who is resistant to the call for the justness of shared well-being, you will experience opposition. You know why, of course. It's because when you come close to someone who has been steeped in dehumanizing or selfish tendencies, and by coming close in a personal way, you compel that person to see you in your full humanity. And that's what close-up encounters with other people shows, our common humanity. When you, the opponent, when you, the person with a different experience or worldview, when you, the person of a different race or ethnicity or language, when you, the stranger, you who claims Christ in a way that is different from the way your neighbor claims Christ, you, the proponent of equality or respect or nonviolence, you, the encourager of moral structural change, you, the advocate for the outsider, when you get close enough to that other person so that other person sees you as human, as much human, as hurting and needful, as much worthy and good as they see themselves, then something has to shift. And often people don't like that. They don't like seeing things that make them have to change the way they have been seeing things. So then not only does your close-up humanness get under their skin, but when you get close enough to say to the person who needs healing, I'm not going to sell it to you, I'm going to give it to you. And this is what healing looks like. It's not just your well-being, it's mine too. It's the benefit to you of having your human rights and your full humanity recognized and honored, but it's also the human rights and full humanity of me, of the neighbor, of the stranger, of the marginalized. When you get close and say those kinds of things, then the person to whom you are offering that help and that healing has no choice but to either see your humanity in the mirror of their own humanity or to turn away. And that's what radical and risky Christ compassion looks like. The willingness to come close and to call forth healing and to ask for hospitality. The willingness to risk resistance as you attempt to invite someone else to engage our common humanity. An engagement which is ultimately what leads to the deepest kind of healing. And this healing, this ministry of radical and risky rehumanizing compassion, this real healing, is so important that if it is rejected, if instead of seeing your humanity in the mirror of their own humanity, the other person chooses to turn away, then you have to keep moving on. Because there are other places where this radical, rehumanizing compassion and healing is urgently needed. Keep finding more soil onto which you can spread the seeds of human healing. all the while knowing that you will face opposition when you offer radical and comprehensive compassion, because there are those who cannot and will not see beyond their own needs, and who call out, "Give it all to me," rather than, "Come alongside me." People who turn away because they cannot bear to have their hearts challenged or changed. Even those in the same families, says Jesus, will sometimes find themselves on opposite sides of the divide. The divide between those who want only their own advantage and those who want the healing of the world. When we finally see each other fully and mercifully, when we finally see and believe in our common humanity, when our courage overcomes our fear, when we see others as Christ sees us, then we will be healed. Then we will be whole. I watched the movie Just Mercy with my family on Friday evening. It's the story of Bryan Stevenson's work with the Equal Justice Initiative, a legal organization that seeks justice for innocent people on death row in Alabama, primarily African Americans. The movie mostly focuses on the story of Stevenson's work with one particular case, the case of Walter McMillan, a black man who was sentenced to die in 1987 for the murder of an 18-year-old white girl, despite the conviction resting entirely on the self-contradictory testimony of a white man who testified against McMillan as an eyewitness in exchange for leniency in his own murder case. In the movie, we see Stevenson finding out that the testimony against his client, who is on death row, was coerced and fabricated, something the witness, Ralph Myers, admits to him. That information is enough to get a court hearing to request a new trial, but at the hearing, the witness, Myers, is suddenly reluctant to say in open court what he has already told Stevenson. The prosecuting attorney, as well as the sheriff who coerced his false testimony, are sitting yards away from him, staring him down. And his willingness to tell the truth and admit his prior perjury falters. In the movie, Myers looks nervously at Sheriff Tate. Stevenson sees what's happening, and he moves his body to stand between Myers and his sight line to the sheriff. And then comes the moment when, although it is not enough to turn the tide completely that day, the tide begins to turn. Stevenson says to Myers, "Can you identify the man you testified against? Is he here today? Can you point him out?" Myers reluctantly looks at McMillan, who is sitting by himself at the table. He points to him. Then he looks at him a little longer. Stevenson says, "I'm going to ask you again, was the testimony you gave against Mr. McMillan true?" Myers continues to look at McMillan. And then he says what we already know, but we have been waiting for him to have the courage to speak in open court. "No," he says. "What I said before was completely false. Mr. McMillan deserves to be released to go home into the arms of his children." Although the story of McMillan's eventual release from death row is true, the staging of that particular moment in the movie may not be precisely accurate. It may have been done to make the scene more dramatic. But what we know is true. From our own experience, from the observable world, is that we will not see past our prejudice. We will not see past our fear. We will not see past our lies to ourselves and to others until we see the humanity, the worthiness of the other. Until we look them in the eye and they look us in the eye, and we see between us the light of truth, of good news. And we see that their healing is our healing too. Jesus is all about good news. He offers it. He sends out his disciples to offer it, the good news of healing, the good news of wholeness, the good news of a oneness that is greater than our separateness. But the good news of Jesus can and will be refused by those who think that they can secure their own good news, guarantee their own benefit by denying the well-being of others. Theirs is a selfish good news, and Jesus won't have it, won't endorse it, won't bend to it, and neither should we. Jesus' good news, our good news, is good news for everyone, because it is about the hope that everyone will benefit from the love and justice of God. Some will refuse such news, but we carry it on anyway. Some will resist it, but we share it anyway. Some will miss it, but we keep offering it anyway. For the Spirit still blows through our lives and in the world, moving us forward into the risk of radical, rehumanizing compassion, giving and receiving gifts of healing and hospitality, encouraging and affirming our common humanity, and seeking to make us whole, all of us. Amen. Some moments of silent reflection.
God of our weary
Thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, Thou who hast by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Lest our feet stray from the places, our God, where we
Jesus, good news, our good news is good news for everyone because it is about the hope that everyone will benefit from the love and justice of God. And when God's love and justice prevails, then the world will be healed. Even if some refuse such news, even if they turn away from such healing, may we carry it on. Amen.
Sometimes in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me. When you're not strong, I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride if I have faith you need to.
Somebody to